Sure. We will be looking at inverse trig functions. So recall, for a function to be inverted, we noted that it has to pass the horizontal line test. Because remember, the idea is when you invert a function, at least graphically, you're reflecting the graph of the function about the line y equals x. And for the resulting graph to pass the vertical line test, so for the resulting graph to be the graph of a function, we require that horizontal line test being passed by the original function. When we think about our trig functions, like sine of x, sine of x fails the horizontal line test spectacularly. So it fails the horizontal line test, I say spectacularly, because we have any horizontal line with a y value between minus 1 and 1 will intercept the graph of sine of x infinitely many times. For cosine of x, we have the same kind of result. So cosine of x also, any line with a y value between minus 1 and 1 intercepts the graph at infinitely many points. So these both fail the horizontal line test. So this means with the functions on their entire domain, we cannot invert them. So what we do is we restrict the domain. So we'll talk about sine in a few minutes, but the way that we'll handle, say, sine of x when we invert it is we say, well, let's restrict it to just this interval here. And when we do so, that restriction will pass the horizontal line test, which means the function with that domain restriction has an inverse. And that's really the main idea for inverting the trig functions, because they all have this property that none of them will pass the horizontal line test. So the first that we'll look at in detail is arctangent. And the notation for this, you'll see arctan of x, and you'll also see tan with a minus 1 superscript. This is not tangent raised to the power minus 1. This is a little bit tricky notation, because if you say have sine with a 2 superscript of x, we interpret that as sine squared x. This, we do not interpret this as a power. This is interpreted as the inverse function of tangent of x, or arctan of x. And you'll see it written both ways. So here's our definition. The inverse tangent or arctangent function is defined as y equals arctan of x if and only if tangent of y equals x. And our restriction is that this will hold for any x in the reals, but the y restriction is to be between negative pi over 2 and pi over 2. So why is this? Let's recall what our tangent function looks like. And remember, because tangent of x is sine of x over cosine of x, tangent had a vertical asymptote for any x value at which cosine of x equals 0. And remember, that happens at odd multiples of pi over 2. So we have these vertical asymptotes at these odd multiples of pi over 2. And recall that the graph looked like this. Great job there. So this function we can see clearly now that we've graphed it, that it does in fact fail the horizontal line test. Any horizontal line that we draw will intersect the graph of tangent of x at infinitely many points. So the natural thing to do here is to restrict the domain of the function to just this piece in the middle. So the piece for the x values between x is negative pi over 2 and pi over 2. So with that restriction, remember that in order to get the inverse, at least the graph of it, we reflect about the line y equals x. So instead of having this behavior with a vertical asymptote at x equals pi over 2 and x equals minus pi over 2, these types of asymptotes will be horizontal at y is pi over 2 and y equals minus pi over 2. So we have these horizontal asymptotes here. And again, to get the graph of the function, we reflect it about the line y equals x. So instead of looking like this, the graph will appear like this. And so this is the graph of arctan of x. And remember, the definition of inverse functions mean inverse functions undo one another. So first of all, tangent of x, or maybe we should say it this way, arctan of x, if you look at the picture, you can see the domain of arctan of x is all x in R. That's why we have here arctan of x is defined on this domain for any x in R. And if we take tangent of arctangent of x, we get x for any x in the real numbers. Remember, the defining characteristic of a pair of inverse functions is that they undo one another, which is what we see here. Similarly, we can go the other way. We can say tangent of arctan of x. And this also, actually, I just wrote the same thing again. What we say here is, we want to do arctan on the outside and tangent on the inside, and they undo one another. But tangent, in this case, we've decided to restrict its domain to minus pi over 2 to pi over 2. So this works for x in the interval, open interval, minus pi over 2 pi over 2. Again, to be consistent with the domain restriction here. And we don't include minus pi over 2 and pi over 2, the endpoints, because the function itself, tangent of x, is not defined at those endpoints. The key thing to recognize, again, is that they undo one another. Now, one thing people often have trouble with when learning these types of functions for the first time is that, how do you think of them? What do you want to think of these? And the key thing to think of when you see something like an arctan or any inverse trigonometric function is you want to think angle. So if we come here, so you have tangent of y equals x. It's often easier to think of this y in terms of theta, because you're taking tangents of angles. That's an often easy and natural interpretation. So if you take arctan of both sides, you get theta equals arctangent of x. And this is a nice way to think of it, because what you can think of this is, and again, we use theta because it makes us think angle, what angle is such that its tangent is x? Okay, so this is the first of the six inverse trigonometric functions. We know where tangent is defined. It's differentiable. Since its graph is merely a reflection about y equals x, we should expect it's also differentiable. And it does, in fact, have a nice derivative. And the derivative of arctan of x with respect to x is 1 over quantity 1 plus x squared. And we can get this pretty quickly and pretty naturally in the following manner. Let's call y the arctan of x. And then we take tangent of both sides. Tangent of y is tangent of arctangent of x, which is x, because tangent and arctangent are inverse functions. All right, well, if tangent of y equals x, then we can differentiate both sides. With respect to x. Now, if y is a function of x, as it is, we need chain rule. So derivative of the outer function with respect to y, and remember that from previous lecture, would be secant squared y times the derivative of the inner function, which is dy dx, and the derivative of the right-hand side with respect to x is just 1. So this means dy dx equals 1 over secant squared of y. Well, let's think about secant squared y. So remember, we have our classic sine squared y plus cosine squared y equals 1 trig identity. And if we want to get a trig identity for secant squared, we need a 1 over cosine squared. So we divide everything here by cosine squared y. So we get sine squared y over cosine squared y plus cosine squared y over cosine squared y is 1 over cosine squared y. That means that's tan squared y plus 1 is secant squared y, we can then use this identity to swap out that secant squared y with 1 plus tangent squared y. So this means dy dx is 1 over 1 plus tan squared y. Well, how does that help us? Let's note that tan squared y, we can come back over here. This is none other than x squared. X is equal to tangent of y. So square both sides. X squared equals tangent squared y. So this becomes 1 over 1 plus x squared, which is what we wanted. So this shows us the proof of this derivative of arctan. Now, how might we use this result? Well, we can start taking derivatives. So in this case, again, we can think of this as our inner function. So if we want the derivative of f with respect to x, our chain rule says derivative of f with respect to u times du dx. The derivative of arctan of u is 1 over 1 plus u squared. And then derivative of the inside, so this is the way of saying the derivative of the outside, leave the inside alone. The derivative of the inside would be times 2x. So we get 1 over 1 plus, plug in for u, quantity x squared plus 3 squared, times 2x. So we have a way of differentiating expressions involving the arctan function. Again, you don't necessarily have to write all this. You can jump straight to this conclusion if you're comfortable with chain rule. But we like to show the steps because sometimes it can be a little bit unclear when we do these questions with new types of functions like these inverse trig functions for the first time. Let's think about some of the other trig functions. As we mentioned in the first slide, because the sine function does not pass the horizontal line test, I'll write it as sine theta this time. We restrict it to be between minus pi over 2 and pi over 2. So with this restriction for sine of x, or sine of theta as I've drawn it, the graph does, in fact, pass the horizontal line test. Slide this yellow line up and down. It only intercepts this blue curve at most one time. And when we invert it, so now the pi over 2 and the minus pi over 2 are on the vertical axes. On the horizontal axis will be between minus 1 and 1. And our function will look, so think about the points. This is the point pi over 2, 1. So over here we have 1 pi over 2. Similarly, this point, minus pi over 2, 1, translates into minus 1 minus pi over 2. And the curvature will go the other way. And so this is y equals arc sine of x. again, you're taking this blue curve with this domain restriction and reflecting that curve about the line y equals x. So the pi over 2 and the minus pi over 2 move from the horizontal axis to the vertical axis, trading roles with the minus 1 and 1 on the vertical axis moving onto the horizontal axis. So you can see here, for arc sine of x, you have to feed it something between minus 1 and 1. So we see it defined for minus 1 and 1. And again, we have that same kind of property. Arcsine of sine of x equals 1. Again, sine we're restricting to be inside this interval minus pi over 2, pi over 2. And sine of arcsine of x, I'm sorry, it was not equal to 1. It should have been equal to x because they undo each other. Sine of arcsine of x equals x, and we have now for x in minus 1, 1. Again, because you can see that arcsine of x, you can see it directly in its picture. Its domain is the interval minus 1, 1. So this is the way we invert the sine function. And again, you can think of it as, if you think of this y, think in terms of theta instead. What is the angle whose sine is equal to x? So if we did an example there, let's see. Suppose we're told theta is, or why don't we make this? We're asked to compute arcsine of root 2 over 2. The way you can think of that is, think of this as an angle. So we say, okay, theta is arcsine of root 2 over 2. Take the sine of both sides. Sine theta is arcsine, or sine of arcsine of root 2 over 2. The sine and the arcsine undo one another, and we get root 2 over 2. And you can see here now, sine of theta equals root over 2. What's the theta, root 2 over 2? What angle theta has that property? And we know that that's pi over 4. So we just computed that arcsine of root 2 over 2 is pi over 4. So that's just an example of how you may actually do a computation with inverse trig functions. And remember, that's the natural thing to think of. When you see an inverse trig function of something, think angle. Similarly, we can differentiate arcsine. And you take it's the same kind of approach to differentiate all these things that we did for arctan. It's the same kind of thing. So the same type of routine, the same type of proof will give us this as a derivative of arcsine of x. So for example, let's look at this question here. If we want the derivative, we use chain rule. Derivative of the outer function, leaving the inner function alone. So that would be 1 over root 1 minus that inner function squared. That inner function was e to the x to the fourth, times the derivative of the inner function with respect to x. And of course, we need chain rule for that inner term. And we also know when we do this, when we simplify this, the exponents multiply. We have to be kind of careful here. This is e to the x to the fourth, all squared. It's the 2 multiplies by the x to the fourth. So we get e to the 2x to the fourth. The derivative of this term, chain rule, derivative of e to something is e to that something times the derivative of that something, which is 4x cubed. So our answer is 4x cubed e to the x to the fourth over the square root of the quantity 1 minus e to the 2x, and it's that x that's raised to the fourth. So this gives us an example of a derivative computation for arc sine. We will continue with our treatment of the other four inverse trig functions, but we will go through in less detail because it's essentially the same story four more times. The next one that we'll look at is arc cosine. For arc cosine, the way that we restrict the cosine function is we will restrict it to the interval 0, pi. And this will be the piece of cosine that we will invert to get the arc cosine function. So the arc cosine function has the following graph. So the x values for our cosine restricted function vary between 0 and pi. So that will happen for the y values for arc cosine. And the y values for our cosine restriction, or, well, as always, for cosine, vary between negative 1 and 1. So that will be our restriction on the x-axis for our arc cosine of x. And so we are, again, we are inverting this about the line y equals x. To get the graph of arc cosine. And so when we do that inversion, again, you swap these points. So instead of pi minus 1, we have the point minus 1 pi. And then instead of the point 0, 1, we have the point 1, 0. And again, flip this about y equals x. So this piece here will be up this way, and this piece here will be down this way. So we get something that looks like this. And also maybe we look at the intercept. So we know this intercept is pi over 2. So that intercept also happens here. And this is our arc cosine function. So we, again, we can see the domain of arc cosine is minus 1, 1. And its range illustrates the restriction 0, pi. And as before, in the previous two cases, cosine and arc cosine will undo one another. So cosine inverse of cosine of x equals x. And then the other way, cosine of arc cosine of x equals x. Again, where you have to honor the domain restrictions. So cosine will be restricted to having x between 0 and pi. so that we actually have the cosine restricted graph passing the horizontal line test. And then we have a similar result. The derivative of arc cosine of x is minus 1 over root 1 minus x squared. Note that that's the negative of the derivative of arc sine. We can also look at arc secant. This is probably the weirdest looking one, because if you remember, it may have been a while, but the graph of secant has these, remember, secant is 1 over cosine of x. Which means we have an asymptote whenever cosine of x is 0, which happens at, remember, cosine of x we have zeros at these odd multiples of pi over 2. So secant of x has these vertical asymptotes at pi over 2. But again, if you recall, secant has this kind of behavior. And it repeats over here. So secant of x, again, fails the horizontal line test for any line with a y value outside of the interval negative 1, 1. And the restriction that we use, in this case, is we go, again, the secants are the ones that look the funniest. We restrict from 0 to pi. So the secant graph that we will get with the restriction is this graph drawn in blue. And the graph with that restriction passes the horizontal line test, with any horizontal line intersecting that blue graph at most once. So you see here, we have that restriction from 0 to pi. Specifically, secant y, that y that we feed it has to be in the interval 0, pi. And again, we have the defining characteristic that they undo one another. So for instance, take the secant of both sides of this expression, you get secant of y equals secant of arc secant of x, which is x. So taking secants of both sides of this expression gives us this. This means when we flip that graph, so when we draw this, again, think of switching the points. Instead of the point 0, 1, we're going to get the point 1, 0. Over here, instead of the point pi minus 1, we're going to get minus 1 pi. And again, let's draw our y equals x for reference, although I didn't do a very good job drawing this to scale. When we invert this, this piece here that's going up and to the right will move down here, also going up to the right, but with downward, what we would call downward concavity. And this piece down here, that's going down and to the left, when we invert it, will still go down and to left, but the concavity will be upward. So we have this. So this is our graph of arc secant of x. Again, a little bit funny. And you see its domain is different than the others, quite a bit different. The domain is everything outside of the open interval minus 1, 1. So another way you might write its domain would be minus infinity to minus 1, including 1, union, sorry, including minus 1, union 1 to infinity. So everything except this interval in the middle. So this is how we get our arc secant graph. But again, it's the same guiding principle, taking secant of arc secant. They undo one another. We also have an expression for its derivative, the derivative of arc secant of x, 1 over absolute value of x times root 1 minus x squared. Arc cosecant. Similar story. We restrict it. The same kind of restriction. Its domain is x bigger than 1, bigger than or equal to 1. It's, if you take cosecant, arc cosecant of x, you get x. And the other way around, cosecant of arc cosecant of x is also x, keeping in mind the domain restrictions. And we have its derivative. And note its derivative is the negative of the derivative of arc secant of x. Again, once you understand how one of these works, you really get the gist for the others. The principle is not really changing. We're doing the same procedure for each. Finally, the last one, arc cotangent. Same kind of story. You have to restrict the domain of cotangent, and cotangent and arc cotangent undo one another. The domain restriction for cotangent is the interval 0, pi. And the derivative of cotangent of x with respect to x, 1 minus 1 over x squared. It's actually the negative of the derivative of arctangent of x. So again, same principle. Restrict the domain so the original trig function passes the horizontal line test. Then you can invert it. And once you have that definition of the inverse cotangent function, you can differentiate it. And you do the derivative in the same manner that we did the derivative in the beginning. Let's do another challenging derivative example. So suppose we want f prime of x here. So we need the derivative of the inner function. Sorry, the derivative of the outer function, leaving the inner function alone. We saw on the previous page, the derivative of cotangent of u minus 1 over 1 plus u squared. So this is minus 1 over 1 plus, leave that whole inner function alone. So that inner function, sine squared of x cubed. And then using chain rule, we have to have this multiplied by the derivative of the inside function with respect to x, which is the derivative of sine squared of the quantity x cubed with respect to x. This is minus 1 over 1 plus. Remember what this is. This is just shorthand notation for the sine of x cubed squared. Why don't we draw it explicitly? Write it explicitly so we're careful. This is sine of x cubed squared. So all we did there was rewrite what's in here. And this derivative, we now need chain rule, but it may also be helpful here to rewrite it, to recall that that's the quantity sine of x cubed squared. So now when we take the derivative of this term, the outer function we have is a square function. So chain rule dictates that we have power rule on this, bring the 2 out front, leave the inside alone, and reduce that exponent by 1. So we get 2 times the quantity sine of x cubed to the 1 times the derivative of the inner function. The derivative, the inner function is sine of x cubed. So this is, there's a lot of chain rule here. So the derivative of the inner function is the derivative with respect to x of sine of x cubed. This is again a chain rule problem. We can simplify here. This is minus 1 over 1 plus the exponents here will multiply. So 1 plus quantity sine of x cubed to the fourth times 2 sine of x cubed. And here, this derivative, again, chain rule, the outer function is sine. So the derivative of sine, we have cosine. And then we leave the inner function alone times the derivative of the inner function, which is 3x squared. Putting this all together, the numerator, we have minus, we have a 2 times 3, so minus 6 times sine of x cubed times cosine of x cubed all over 1 plus, and we can write that if we want as sine to the fourth of x cubed. And this would be our final answer. This is a challenging problem because we had so many uses of chain rule here. And it's often more straightforward to do your bookkeeping if you do it in this manner, where instead of just banging out the whole computation in one step, do your chain rules one at a time. So here we had the derivative of the first outer function, leaving the inner function alone, and then just say, okay, times the derivative of that inner function. And then you can hack away at these one step at a time. And it's easier, in at least for me, not to make a mistake doing things this way. So again, this would be an example of a tough chain rule problem, a really tough chain rule problem, I would say, that involves an inverse trig function. Now, one question that's always asked, what do we have to know by heart? And the two things that you want to know by heart are these following derivatives. Or we'll say, to memorize. One will be the derivative of arctan of x with respect to x, that being 1 over 1 plus x squared. And the other to know by heart is the derivative of arcsine. And that's 1 over root 1 minus x squared. So these are the two that I would expect you to know on a, say, in an exam setting. In a homework setting, they're all fair game. But for an exam, these would be the two to know. So hopefully this got the idea across, and you see that when you first learn these trig inverse trig functions, you're really doing the same thing, the same procedure, 6 times.